comfortable, this is SIPPA. We have some new, come on in. See, so we've got some new faces here tonight, that's good. My name's Alan Miller, I'm president of SIPPA. Take a minute or two, just since we do have some new people here, let you know a little bit about our group. We've been around for quite a while, we meet here once a month. This is what we call our main meeting. It's more of the general type topics. A lot of us are IT tech people, sysadmin type, sort of, but not exclusively. We have some other people that aren't quite as in the same stream as all of us, but just everybody's got a general interest in technology. We get speakers each month, we talk about different things. Sometimes it's hardware, sometimes it's software, sometimes it's services, or just general topics of interest. Besides this group, we have one or two subgroups that meet different nights of the month. One we call the Small Business Server Group, for lack of a better name. The product's gone, but we still have the same kind of focus. We have another group that's Security SIG. We have a website, simpa.org. Thank you. Never. But this has general resource, tell you about our group. We have a few mailing lists, and you can sign up for any of those. Basically, we're a 501c3 organization. It means we're nonprofit. We charge an annual membership of $35 a year. If you're a student, that's it's $10 for the first year. And if you're not a member, we ask for $5 at meeting for this meeting. The other meetings, there's no charge for it. Basically, that covers refreshments. We get pizza brought in halfway through the meeting. Socializing. We have a few mailing lists. Anybody can sign up on those lists. One is just for general announcements, notices about this meeting, upcoming speakers and such. The others are more discussion type.
Directly related to the SIGs.
Thank you. You want them up?
The
Small Business Server has SIG has a mailing list. Those are good references. We also have a jobs that has some activity, not a lot. So those are references you're welcome to use. We hope you guys come back. If there's anything particularly of interest to you that you'd like to hear covered more in one of our meetings, I'd be happy to hear that from you. Our next month's speaker is going to be Ryan, right back there. He's with CenturyLink, IT, ISP, locally in the area. He's going to talk to us about their offerings, things that can help us and our businesses.
How to make you money.
And how to make you money. Thank you. Always a good thing. Tonight's speaker is Troy Davis. Getting ready to come up. I was going to talk about a hot topic that I'd love to know more about, and I think you guys were here for that. So I'm going to turn it over to Troy. Tell us about what you do too, before about your subject.
I got the other
speech to know more about that.
All right. Hi, everybody.
Hello.
I work for a company called Lampros Labs. It's something I started about 3 years ago, a little over 3 years ago. I recruit talented young developers, mostly college students. Some of them are transitioning, early career transitions. They might have gotten a degree in art or something, decided they want to be a programmer. So I work with them, I give them projects with my clients, work with a lot of agencies, advertising agencies, and also I work with a lot of startups. And working with the startups, I've gotten involved in cryptocurrency in the last couple of years. It's pretty darn interesting stuff. And it's kind of an interesting rabbit hole. I want to take down a little bit of the rabbit hole tonight. It's not exactly a real direct technology speech in some ways. I've got a couple of other purposes that I want to try to communicate here, hopefully. But let's go ahead and get into it if it's all right. First thing I want to ask real quick though is, anybody here actually, I use the term, anybody here hodling tokens right now, cryptocurrency? Anybody?
Say again?
Hodling. Yeah, I said it, that's true. We don't say holding for whatever reason, we say hodling. It's because somebody mistyped it very fast early on in the crypto space, and the term stuck, because it kind of implies the rushed kind of, you know, ill-considered desire to, you know, do I really want to sell it, do I want to hold the tokens, you know? There's that nervousness about it. So for whatever reason, hodling stuck around. But anyway, has anybody got tokens in cryptocurrency right now? You do? Anybody else? I do too. I actually bought just a few of them myself as an experiment at one point and converted them all into my own private currency. And I made $5 of the 77 billion tokens. They're probably worth less than a Satoshi, if you know what a Satoshi is. All right, so the premise of this is really that cryptocurrency is kind of an outgrowth of a larger pattern that's happened to us, I think, repeatedly. Recent past, which is that we seem to be using science fiction as a way to map our direction toward possible futures that we want. I think we use science fiction like that a lot. It's actually pretty well established historically. If you look at, for instance, Jules Verne in 1865 wrote about that for a reason. In 1902, there was a nice French film, very cute girls in ballet outfits come out of a rocket on the moon. It's very cute. But by 1969, of course, we actually went. So 104 years between the time of the conception of the idea to implementation. It's a pretty long timeline. Nobody really, I doubt anybody lived to see from publication of Jules Verne. But it's just outside of a single human lifetime, a long human lifetime. But there's more examples of that too. So the tricorder, right, introduced in the 60s in the Star Trek TV series, and I'm going to be making a lot of references to Star Trek. I'm a fan. I've watched all of the shows. And actually, one of the things that really puzzled me about Star Trek was that they suggested inventions that we seem to accelerate towards very quickly. Because I was growing up in the 80s, watching reruns of the old Star Trek series. And then the Next Generation came out. And when the Next Generation came out, there were several situations where they talked about money and how money plays a role in their society in the future. I thought it was fascinating. But think for a moment about the tricorder and how that concept ultimately developed into what I think is really the smartphone now. We've really implemented the tricorder in a lot of ways. I know there's things there. If you know anything about these, you can say, oh, well, it does, you know, mass spectroscopy and all this. Actually, there is a mass spectroscopy add-on you can get for a tablet. And the other thing I'll mention about it, and I know we all love our phones, really. We all love our phones, right? But these guys actually invented the first medical tricorder last year. It's called Dexter. It can diagnose, I think, 47 different illnesses without a trained medical technician running it. And you basically hook up a couple pieces of hardware, depending on what you're trying to diagnose, to this tablet. Runs the software, it'll coach the person through an analysis process, and they can diagnose various kinds of diseases. Pretty amazing. Successful too. This group did this as part of the XPRIZE challenge, and they got a $2.5 million check, which you can see right there, for developing it. And if I'm not mistaken, I think he actually made an iPhone interface or an Android interface that looks like an old 60s version of that, just to control it, which I thought was just kind of fun. That's kind of neat, right? So in this case, look at the timeline here for just a moment. Sorry, this one. 1964 to 2007. So in 43 years. So in 43 years, we went from inception of the concept to implementation in the public. By their timeline, by the way, in the Star Trek universe, that was 2237. I looked it up in the Star Trek Wikipedia. 2237 was supposed to be the invention of the tricorder. So by my account, they were about 230 years ahead of their timeline. This is a repeating pattern that I'm seeing. Sci-fi predicts things that they think are going to take a lot longer. If you go back to Jules Verne, think about if you would ask somebody in 1865, how long do you think it'll take before humans actually visit the moon, physically step on the surface? think most people would say, never, right? 500 years, 1,000 years, we don't know, right? But we made it just over 100. And in this case, we implemented a major technological goal from sci-fi in about 43 years. Pretty incredible, really. The timeline keeps shortening on these things, too. So we're getting better and better at using sci-fi as a map to get to the future even faster than what sci-fi ever can think of, which I think is fantastic. Let me get back to where I was there. So one of the things that you got to talk about is in Star Trek, they did have a concept of currency, but it wasn't money. They said specifically that they didn't have money anymore. As a matter of fact, Jean-Luc Picard is kind of famous. He's kind of a meme on the internet. You know, money doesn't exist in the 24th century, right? But they did have these things called credits, and that's why I had this image here. And we don't ever see credits. They never show us what credits are, which I think is interesting, too, because they appear to be somehow exchanged electronically. It's sort of like crypto. It's kind of neat. They don't have full dollar bills for credits in the Federation. They don't have coins or chips of any kind. And yet, you know, it's a weird thing, but there's not a lot of things that they actually need to buy. Almost everything that they need on a daily basis is so cheap to provide to them that it's just part of their societal infrastructure. You don't have to buy clothing, you just replicate it. You don't need to buy a gun, you just replicate it. You don't need to buy scientific instruments, you just replicate them on demand. You've got a pattern, topography, interpretation, boom, we've got real prices. So it's a fascinating thing.
Buy the replicator.
Yeah, buy the replicator. The first one must have been really expensive, right? But the key here is that crypto, much like credits in Star Trek, is not actually currency. They're tokens. And I want to talk a little bit about the distinction there between currency and tokens, because it's actually really important, especially when you talk about taxes. So if you're familiar at all with any kind of money actually being used in Star Trek, and you're familiar with these guys, the Ferengi. And the Ferengi are really kind of the capitalists of the Star Trek universe, right? And they start off coming off as really, really negative, and they're viewed very poorly early on in the series when they first introduced. But eventually, it's interesting, this guy Quark here, he makes a really impassioned defense at one point for the necessity of their profit scheme and how it keeps the universe from breaking apart at the seams and killing each other. It's kind of an interesting argument. I don't know if it's really an awesome argument, but it's a pretty good argument. But you know, these guys are fascinated by money. And of course, they have their own currency that they call gold pressed Latin, I believe is what they call it. Yeah, Latin. And that's their currency. If anybody else wants to trade with them, they have to convert whatever currency they've got to Latin first to interact with the franc. So ostensibly, they have conversion rates for alien currency, and there's some kind of fee for exchanging money, of course. I'm sure that's part of it. But they are doing some type of currency exchange for a real piece of currency, which has some type of tangible physical value itself, right? And you know, our money for a long time actually did have a lot of tangible value. I mean, this quarter actually still has some tangible value to it. It's not a lot of metal that's in there. There's a little bit of metal in there that's actually worth some money. If I melted this down and found somebody in the open market who wanted a tiny amount of this metal, or if I melted down 500 quarters or something, I could probably sell this for less than probably a quarter. But I could sell it. It has a material value that's useful for some other purpose and be repurposed. And that's really what currency was originally, was something that you could reuse for some other purpose if you had to. It's intrinsic value. But of course, the problem now is that we've got this paper money stuff. And, you know, although it's nice artwork and everything, this used to be backed by gold at one time, but not anymore. Right? So this doesn't actually represent any tangible material wealth anymore. This is a contract with the United States government. It's the faith and credit of the U.S. government that says that if I present this bill, any place where a currency is accepted in the United States, they should be able to exchange it for fair value market trade of something worth about $5. So I should be able to buy a hamburger, just about anywhere, except for some pretty expensive burger. But I should be able to buy a hamburger just about anywhere for this $5 bill. And we all agree that this $5 bill is worth about a decent hamburger. That's what gives it its value. This is consensus agreement on the valuation of the currency. So because we as a group agree this is worth about a hamburger, who do I hamburger with? So crypto is no different, and Latinum was no different than Star Trek. the valuation of any currency is really based on our consensus judgment of its worth. If we suddenly had a crisis of faith in the U.S. government or its currency or its banking system or something like that, I know it's never happened, right? Nobody's ever had this problem. But if that ever were to become a real major issue, our currency would decline in value simply because we lost faith. And because I no longer believe that $5 is worth a good burger anymore, I'll say, look, I'll give you some French fries for $5, but not a burger. It just devalued, right? It just deflated. So what I'm trying to get across here is that our currency, actually, as much as everybody tells us that it's really the gold standard, it's not anymore. The gold standard is a misnomer now for the US dollar. It's not gold standard bank. It's a consensus transaction. We all agree what it's worth, and that's what gives it its worth. And the franc, you're in the same position. It gave value to latinum. Who knows whether it had a real tangible use or not? I'm not sure this other sci-fi thing. That's what they were into. The tokens themselves actually had quite a long history in our society. Going back to 1865, and we had a couple of retailers starting to issue tokens. And you can see these tokens had ID numbers on them, and that represented an account. And they kept a book with your account on it, how much credit you had, and you brought your token in, and that represented how much credit you had at that establishment. And you could exchange it for whatever goods you wanted. You didn't turn your token in, though. You just kept your token as long as you had a balance. Right? It's like an ID card, or it was like a token in some ways. But in 1888, this guy, Edward Belling, wrote this book called Looking Backward, where he hypothesized of a man going from the year 2000 back to the year 1887. And he's looking at the world and remarking on it and how different it is from the world that he just came from and telling them about the future to come and what things would happen. And he describes an interesting thing. Yes.
Okay. I want to interrupt. I'll be right back. I just want to.
Do you want me to come talk
yeah.
to
you?
Okay. I'm sorry. Hang on.
Sorry.
Bye.
Anybody wants to check in?
So Edward Bellamy came up with the idea of the idea that we would eventually not need coins, or we would not need foldable money in order to do transactions, and that we'd all carry around an ID card of a sort, and that ID card would represent how much value we had stored with our banks, and that we could then take it into any place and exchange that for goods and services. And he basically predicted the credit card, which by 1959, the Bank of America card is probably the first credit card that ever existed that was accepted by many different retailers. It allowed the vision of what Edward Bellamy had written about to become manifest reality. So again, it's another, so it's that 70 some years that took us to get from looking backward to the actual credit card. But the thing about tokens was that we did move on from tokens with ID numbers onto to tokens that actually represented value store, right, or store of value. And those tokens, like if anybody remembers Aladdin's Castle, right? I remember it very well myself, you took a dollar and you put it into a machine, normally you got back 4 tokens. If you were lucky, it was a good day, you got back 5 tokens, and you could then use those tokens to play a video game, right? Now, I couldn't turn my tokens. Was that not?
I still have some of those.
You still have those?
I still have some of that.
Now, the tokens, of course, aren't worth a quarter. And they're probably not worth a quarter. Tokens themselves didn't have any intrinsic value, but what they represented is what you could get for that token. It was a video game, right? You played a video game. That was a spot of joy in my childhood. So the tokens themselves became a value store, even though they intrinsically did not have value themselves. And that's the important thing about the tokens. This is also what crypto has to its credit, is that it's a value store. Again, based on consensus judgment of what we think it's worth. Right? Sometimes Aladdin's Castle thought that my dollar was worth 4 tokens. Sometimes they thought my dollar was worth 5 tokens. I really liked them when it was 5 tokens. So that consensus value of what that dollar was worth in tokens is much like how we look at Bitcoin being worth so many thousands of dollars today. It's a consensus agreement. Okay. All right. So the tokens really helped us to, and I guess the double entry accounting system that we developed is a way that we prevented what we call the double spend problem. And this was present with tokens, because if you had a token with an ID on it, you came into one store and said, well, I've got $5 credit and I want $5 worth of goods. Then you left. Nobody wrote down anything. Then you came back and said, see my token? I've got $5 worth of credit. I want $5 worth of goods. And you gave $5 worth of goods. Well, you just gained $10 worth of stuff for $5 worth of credit. Double spent your credit, right? So the double spending problem is a big issue. And in cryptocurrency especially, it's a big issue, because I can duplicate any digital file very easily, very quickly, at very low cost. So a token represented by a Bitcoin or an Ethereum block or any of those things can be easily digitally copied. So how do we know that when somebody spends that token that they don't spend it again? And double entry ledgers are the way we use them, right? So you have debit one column and credit the other, right? So anytime you take a debit out of here, put it into cash. So it was a debit out of cash and it was applied to an account, right? So that double entry system we actually use in crypto as well, so that we can't get into the double spend problem. So the ledger is the blockchain in this case. Blockchain is basically a distributed ledger. So everybody's computer has chunks of it. On some of the older blockchain-based technologies, we have an entire copy of the whole blockchain on our systems when we interact with it. Some of the better designed ones that are newer, you don't have to have the entire blockchain locally in order to operate it, but you'll have some portion of it. And that portion that you have is networked with everybody else who has portions of it too. So everybody has these redundant overlapping copies of the exact same ledger. And they all do correlative network updates amongst themselves in order to keep up on who spent what to whom, who sent which value to whom, what do these tokens now belong to, right? Who owns these tokens now? And those correlative updates come through the network in waves. And that's how we do a double entry ledger system on what we call a distributed ledger. Distributed ledgers aren't that new either, by the way. There was paper distributed ledgers back with Woolworths way long time ago, because they had credit systems and a token system of some other type. And you could have an account with Woolworths, and you could go to one store and spend some money. And if you went to the next store in the next town the next day, they already had an update by paper that told them that you had used your credit. So that way you couldn't double spend. They were pretty effective at it, actually. They had a really good system worked out for sending messages out in all directions to make sure that their stores had constant updates. And I think Telegraph also played a big part in that, too. They started using Telegraph as a messaging system in order to communicate that information between their cities. So distributed ledger isn't really that new. I know everybody thinks blockchain is really cool new technology. The funny thing is, it's sort of like, you know, you put rocket engines strapped into a Model T, shot them into space. So there's a lot of things here that already existed. Now, this is really how a blockchain works real quick. And if anybody doesn't know how a blockchain works, if you know how it works already, I'm going to bore you for a minute. Sorry, ghost or whatever. But this is really important so that you understand the part that's coming up. So I'm not going to show you block one, because block one, by the way, doesn't have a hash of the previous block at all. Because block one is what we call a genesis block. The genesis block doesn't have a prior hash because there's nothing before. So we'll start with block two. This is a little easier to talk about. So block two is assembled by miners. All blocks are assembled by miners. Miners are basically just computers that chew on the data from the blockchain in order to, number one, process transactions, turn those into blocks, and introduce them into the network. Number two, they'll validate transactions. And in some cryptocurrencies, they actually execute things called smart contracts. We'll talk about all of those things in a minute. But the big important piece of information is that these blocks are assembled in groupings. So think of it as a whole bunch of transactions come into the clearinghouse of your bank to be cleared at once. The miners gather up a bunch of them and put those into a block, and format them into a block of data. And now I run an algorithm over those in order to generate a hash signature. It's basically sort of like if I added every letter as a number in the alphabet of all of these things up and got a total number of all of those in addition, that's a sort of a checksum, right? So a hash signature is a lot like a checksum in that regard. It's a way of being able to go back and verify. If I use that hash calculation, I should be able to then re-add everything that's in that block. And when I run the same algorithm on it, I should get the exact same hash. If I don't, somebody might keep that block. That makes the network reject that version of the block and look for other versions of it that do agree with the hash signature. So a hash is usually stored from the previous block at the top of every block. So I'm going to say block one's hash becomes the very first entry in my block two. And then I've got my transaction block. That's all of the transactions that I gathered up, and I've processed those, and I've thought about them, and I've calculated an in-check sum, and I'm going to advertise along with the timestamp. I'm going to advertise here, I just completed this work, here's my proof of work, here's my hash signature I calculated for this new block. Other nodes in the network will then pick that up and validate it. And if it validates, it becomes part of the blockchain, officially. And at that point, it's kind of an indelible record. It's very hard to go back and change these things because, as you notice, the hash of the previous block goes into each new block. So every time, that's why it's a chain. It's a chain because the hash starts the new block. The hash from the old block starts the new block. The hash from that block starts the next block. And in this way, you can prevent someone from going back and trying to alter history somehow in order to fake transactions or to transfer money to their own account without having
built-in audit trail. The right way to do it.
Sorry?
The built-in audit trail.
Yes. Yeah, that's correct. It's distributed, though, so it's a little complicated. And the way that this works is it's also consensus-based, by the way. The network has to have a consensus about reality because there are times where I cannot tell whether this block is true or whether that block is true. Both of their hashes check out. They've got different timestamps. And now the network is going to have to vote on which block is going to be reality.
If I'm processing in block two of my transactions something different than what Chad's computer is processing in its transactions, our hash in block three is going to be different.
That's right. And when you submit your block, if your block is longer than his, yours wins.
Because I processed more transactions.
Because you did more work. You produced proof of more work than you did in that block of transactions. So therefore, your version of reality is accepted by the network.
Regardless of whether my CPU is accurate or not?
Well, if the checksum didn't line up, if the hash couldn't be recomputed and validated, then it would reject your block. So it still has to be a valid block in the sense that the hash has to check out when you run the algorithm on that block of transactions again. But remember, okay, the block starts with the hash of the previous block. Right?
Okay, so someone else has to run the transactions and come out with the same number.
That's right.
So if I had an old Pentium 90 chip that had the...
Don't do that.
I have one of those, by the way. Yeah.
Don't mine crypto. You're burning money. That's what you're doing. So, I have a lot of people say, hey, I have an old laptop. I'd like to mine some crypto. Wish I'd do it as a throw in the garbage. get 10 bucks for it. Put it through your next machine. No, don't mine crypto on the hardware. You're not doing yourself good.
I wasn't planning on it, but...
Yeah. Yeah, you
it
could.
It doesn't mean Intel or AMD won't produce another batch of bad silicon.
True. But, at that point, though, your checksums won't match. Okay. If that's the case, you have an error of some kind, right? The rest of the network can eject your block and take chance instead.
That's what I'm asking.
And you said your block gets longer and longer, right?
Well, the chain gets longer, right? Now, miners will gather up as many transactions as they want to. That's kind of the configuration that the miner can do. It's kind of a range. It's what's available on the network, what they can grab easily. So they'll grab a bunch of transactions, put that into a block. And when we've got multiple blocks coming up that have the same parent hash from the previous block, then the longest block is the one that becomes consensus reality. No, because they're limited. So there's max block size. Usually, most cryptocurrencies right now, it's 1 or 2 megabytes. So, we're not talking about a lot of data, actually. That's one of the things that's kind of funny. Everybody says, oh, you're running crypto miners, right? Oh, you must have an awesome internet connection. You run that off of 56K mobile. Are you kidding me? Right? There's no reason that you have to have incredible bandwidth in order to do crypto mining. Because most of what crypto mining is chewing up resources on the CPU. You're doing math. You're proving your work. That's what proof of work means, right? So you're doing the math, burning energy in order to compute that algorithm in order to verify that I've got a checksum that matches, and here's my transaction block, and either I validated a bunch of transactions, or here's a new block I'm introducing to that. Did I answer the question? All right, so this is really how this stuff works, right? Now, this is the very simplified version of it. There's more complex versions of it. I'm going to show you one in just a second, because this is a really good lifetime view. So this, real-time view of the Ethereum blockchain with a delay. I mean, it's like the NFL, right? You don't see it. So if you're going and looking at exactly the delay it's blocking is Ethereum, if you've got a fast connection right now, it won't be that. But these are transactions coming into the network. They're pairing up. And miners, as you see them disappear, miners are grabbing them out of the stack. And so and when enough of these transactions are grouped up, so you can just say, there you go. So you just created a new block that threw those transactions into that new block. So a miner downloaded those transactions, computed a checksum, introduced it back to the network, said, here's a new block. Everybody on the network said, looks good to me. Then it became a new block that's part of the consensus reality. It's interesting, though. Notice these red blocks. In Ethereum, they have possibly what you call an uncle block. This is not something that you can have in Bitcoin, for instance. Because in Bitcoin, an uncle block would just be rejected. It would be invalid. The work that was done to generate it is completely wasted. Energy down the toilet.
So would, if it got rejected, then would those transactions go back into the pot?
The pool. Okay. Yeah, for Bitcoin, that's true. Now, for Ethereum, they decided that this was actually a valuable thing, that the uncle blocks were actually valuable. Because whenever you make a block, you always set aside a certain amount. You can see there's empty spots in most of these blocks, right? Those blocks have intentionally empty slots in them that can be useful for miners. So as miners mine a block, there's two things that can happen. One is that we just validate transactions in that block. The second thing that can happen is that we discover an open token in that block that's not used. And if I find that token, that's mine. So I did the proof of work, so I get to claim it.
What's the difference? Yellow and red.
Yeah, these are kind of interesting. So these yellow ones are smart contracts invocations. So it's an attempt to try a smart contract and see if it'll execute. I'll explain the smart contract in a second. These blue ones are new, transactional announcer. I forget what that one was called. It'll actually tell us what it is. So that's a contract creation. So that's a new contract being created. Those blue ones are the same thing. The yellow ones are actually transactions. So you'll see that a lot of these actually have non-zero values, 0.11, 0.15, gray ones have transactions associated with them. So some of these are actually transactions. Some of them are just validations that have happened.
So the blue ones, someone just bought a burger. Just bought a burger.
No. Okay, so let me explain smart contracts so it'll make a little more sense. So a smart contract would be something like, for instance, I'm going to send Chad a Bitcoin. I'm going to send Chad a Bitcoin if the New York Times reports that President Trump has resigned before the end of his term of office. So I can write a program that checks the New York Times latest news feed and sees whether or not there's a headline that indicates that Trump has resigned. Okay? I've got to have some heuristics in there to weed out the language and that sort of thing. There's got to be some rules for this, right? Because it's a rule-based system. There's no human making a judgment on this. So I'd have to be kind of good about that. But if I can write a contract that can do that, I can make a bet to Chad. I can say, okay, you set up a smart contract, and if he serves out his full term without being impeached or resigning, then you send me a paper. So now we got a bet, right? We'll see what happens. Now, if the headline ever comes out that Trump resigns or is impeached or something, then automatically, just because that headline showed up and our contract got executed by a miner, the miner is going to go check the New York Times, see if that headline is there, if it matches. Chad gives me a Bitcoin, just like that. He doesn't have to do anything. It just happens. And if Trump serves out his full term without any problems and makes it through it, by that date, that would also trigger my contract and send him a Bitcoin.
So maybe this is an oversimplification, but if you're the one that wrote that program and you're the one making the bet, then I have to trust that you wrote that program properly?
We'd have to have a mutual contract that we can share, so we'd have to run the same contract. And you can see it by the calculation of the checksum whether or not it's true. So we could check each other's bet to make sure that we use the same code. Now, could I come up with code that could evaluate to the same checksum but have a different output? Maybe if I was incredible at programming, like way above human level, right? That's pretty crazy. There is one case of that I do know of that has happened where that's occurred, but it didn't have anything to do with crypto. It was the Heartbleed vulnerability. If anybody remembers Heartbleed, anybody remember that one? Yeah, that's So somebody actually put a vulnerability into the Apache web server that allowed you to send a specially crafted packet to it, packet sequence. And if you did, it would dump the private keys for the SSL certificates on that web server back to the person that requested it. It's really convenient if I want to snoop on all of the encrypted communication going back and forth between people in that web server. So if I do that, I can interpret all of the messages coming to that web server that are encrypted for that web server. That was Heartbleed. And we don't really know who did it. It's a lot like Satoshi Nakamura. We don't know if Satoshi Nakamura is either supposedly the inventor of Bitcoin. Probably not actually a person at all. Probably a group of people that hid behind a pseudonym. But I think we'll see evidence of them show up here in a few minutes, actually. But yeah, so did that answer the question? So this is really what it looks like as the block is being assembled, right? This blockchain is being assembled right now. This is a real-time view of it. And this is symbolic. You know, the blocks don't actually look green or red or anything. They just contain text, right? But the text are, you know, the blocks are 1 megabyte, 2 megabytes in size, something like that. Maybe a little shorter, a little bit more. That's pretty much it.
What are the lines?
Lines on top.
Yeah, so the lines show parentage, right? So these two blocks, this block is actually leading to this uncle block that got banned. This uncle block actually gets picked up by this block as a predecessor. Now, I mentioned that uncle blocks actually play an important role because they have space available for miners to exploit. We don't actually use any of the transaction records that are in an uncle block, but we'll keep open those open spaces and hope that a miner finds something in that's useful for them. And it encourages people to mine the network. If you don't have miners mining the network, nobody executes the smart contracts. It's important that miners operate on an Ethereum blockchain. If you don't have them, you don't have a blockchain. So miners are an important component to this ecosystem in order to make it work. All right, let's get at that.
Is that how you define how popular a cryptocurrency is?
What do you mean there?
I mean, everyone's looking for the next Bitcoin. There's 1,000 other cryptocurrencies out there, but why would anyone invest in any of them? Because until they're identified as the next Bitcoin.
Sorry, give me 1 second. I'm sorry, I'm a little distracted with the fact of this. Somehow I closed my presentation. I'm sorry. Repeat that just one more time, please.
How do you define the next Bitcoin?
The next Bitcoin? You mean the next one in the chain or just the next thing like Bitcoin that's a different ICO?
Second one.
Okay. Different ICOs or different coins or different tokens have different types of networks and properties. And it's all about the code that was written to manage that system.
So I imagine this is one of those others.
Yes, Ethereum is an alternative to the blockchain from Bitcoin. Right? So Bitcoin is the simplest blockchain implementation that exists. It doesn't have smart contracts. It does use miners, but it uses an SHA-256 hash signature, which is easily computed on a lot of kind of different devices. Most people just use GPU-based computer, GPU cards, like graphics cards. They use those to crunch Bitcoin if you're gonna try to mine it. It's actually not worth mining right now. It's not a good idea to go mining Bitcoin because there's too many other people trying to do it. That's really, there's a crowd effect that doesn't benefit there. There's too many people mining the same currency at once, and something we call complexity goes up. When complexity goes up, that means that your rate of discovery of new tokens goes way down. The way that you really make money when you mine crypto is when you discover blocks. And people are so impatient to get those blocks discovered that they actually gang up into pools, mining pools, so that we can distribute the risk across the pool and share the rewards of the discovered blocks. And I pay a 5%, or sometimes 3%, 1.5%, depends on the pool, how generous they are and how big they are. But big pools usually charge a pretty good percentage. And they take a percentage of your take, right? You get a little bit of everything. So the mining pool operators actually do very well in that system. But that allows me, instead of waiting for the average, statistical probability to play out for me to find one Bitcoin in the next 15 years, I'll work with a whole bunch of other miners. Somebody else is going to discover a block tomorrow, and I'll get a piece of it because I'm in the pool with them. Okay? So it's like buying lottery tickets with everybody in the world. Right? Spread out your chance to win.
Yeah, I get that. I was wondering the alternative ones, why Ethereum?
Well,
as opposed to dot Ethereum.
A couple things. Why? Let's talk about this because I think this will help. So, think about this for a moment. Is Bitcoin really a currency or an asset? Because that's actually a really important question right now to the IRS and the SEC. Because if you've got to pay taxes on income that you've made off of Bitcoin investments, you've got to determine whether it's an asset or whether it's a currency. There are different tax rates. One of them's capital gains, which will be profit. Right? If it's an asset, if it's a currency, you've got to pay currency exchange rates, currency exchange taxation, right, on that kind of thing. It's personal income. It's a much higher tax rate. So this is still hot water legally. People are still debating this pretty heavily. The IRS currently says, their latest thing, is that all crypto assets are assets, not currencies. So they made the determination that it's all assets, which means that you should be able to pay capital gains taxes on it all. But everybody I know that has crypto is paying personal income tax on it, higher rate, because they don't think that the IRS knows what they're doing. I think that would be fair to say. So there's a confusing problem, we'll get to that in a few minutes, but think about this for a moment. This coin, by the way, is the oldest coin that has ever been recovered. It's from a Greek city-state, 700 BC. It's the earliest coin we know about. But it is definitely a currency. It has tangible value. It's made out of a precious metal. You can melt that down and use it for different purposes. It's tangibly valuable. Bitcoin is not. That 1 megabyte block that has my $11,000 token in it, 12,000, whatever it is today, it's just text. It has no intrinsic value. It doesn't even exist manifestly. It only exists as an abstract concept on my hard drive as a pattern of electrons stored on my SSD. Right? So it doesn't really have an intrinsic value in and of itself. I don't think Bitcoin is a currency. It's a token. It's true. It's not really a currency. And by the way, there's a big problem with all of this, because if you look at this little chart that I found online, they're starting to find some of these as cryptocurrencies, which, by the way, I think they categorized ETH. Yeah, I think they categorized ETH correctly. Ethereum, in my opinion, is a utility token because it has smart contracts. It does something. It's not just a unit of exchange. It's not just a store of value. It actually has executable code attached to it that does work. I think that's a utility token. Other utility tokens are things like Seacoin or Filecoin or Civicoin. Seacoin and Filecoin are both the same thing. They're basically Dropbox in the blockchain. So if I want to store files in the Seacoin blockchain, I buy some Sea tokens. And with those tokens, I can fill them up with my data. So I literally encode my files into the blockchain and upload them, and that becomes a new block in the same blockchain. Because I own that token, I can put data that I want to in. So my file, as long as the Seacoin network exists and people are still mining Seacoin, people still have Seacoin wallets running, my files are still available on cloud. And anybody can download that file if I want to give them access to it. If I give them the address to that node in the blockchain, they'll be able to download my file. So it's a lot like Dropbox, except I don't have to pay Dropbox. I don't have a centralized control structure telling me what I can and can't do with my file storage. Nobody can really charge me for it. I pay in terms of electrical cost in order to do the physical math work in order to store my files. So I'm paying with electricity, but that's pennies. It's a hell of a lot cheaper to block, right, than a Dropbox, let me tell you. So Seacoin's very interesting. That's a utility token. And here's the thing. So if it's a currency, we have regulations that can deal with that. We know how to deal with currencies already. And if it's a security, if it represents tangible property in some way, let's say that this is a deed for a house, this represents the ownership of the house, we're encoding that in the blockchain. Well, that's a security. That's definitely something that we don't have regulations already. Utility tokens are tough. We don't really have good regulations for this, because we've never had this thing where a money does work. That's never existed before. That's a new concept. So if money does work or has an alternative use besides being money itself, we're starting to define those as utility tokens. The legal status of those are very unclear. So if you make any money on Seacoin, I advise paying personal income taxes. Regardless of what the IRS does right now. Because they might change your mind and you're still going to be responsible for that tax amount, probably retroactively. So this is a simplified view of all of this. It can actually get a lot more complicated. I'm not going to go into all of this, by the way. I just wanted to show you. Somebody else is working really hard to try to figure out how to categorize the different cryptocurrencies that are out there and define what types they are and what they do. And we might eventually see policy wonks in the government figure out how to do specific policies regulate these very particularly. And I think new classes will evolve over time too, as we invent new ways to use these to do other kinds of computing problems. So this is going to be an ongoing challenge for our governments to catch up with regulation in order to prevent negative outcomes like stock market crashes. Right? We were talking a little bit earlier about accredited investor status. Has anybody in here been an accredited investor now or in the past? I'm not either. So, in order to be an accredited investor, you have to have like $150,000 income for 3 years average out in the last 3 years. There's a bunch of other stipulations. You have to do residency requirements and that sort of thing. Basically, what it is that the government doesn't want the average citizen to do what they did back in the 20s, which was leverage most of their assets against stocks or investments. Because as a herd, we're not very good investors. Whenever one member of the herd peels off and starts running in the opposite direction, there's a tendency for most of the herd to turn around and follow. Because we think they just found something out that we don't know about. We better run that way. We don't know what's coming over there. Right? That herd behavior is actually very dangerous on a mass level with economics. That's essentially why we had a stock market crash. We had a bunch of investors that didn't know what they were doing and responded very badly to a stressful situation. And they all responded at once the same direction. That killed the stock market.
Herd stampede.
Yeah, it was a really bad situation. We don't want those again. Those were terrible times. There was a decade to recover from that, maybe more. Some people say it didn't really end until the beginning of World War II. That was a long time to be poor as a nation. Nobody wants to go back there. So accredited investor rules, they call them KYC. They probably are still important. I find it a little difficult though now because an ICO will come out and you have to be an accredited investor to buy any significant amount of it. You need more than a couple hundred bucks. That to me sounds bad. I think it would make more sense if we had some kind of a logical limit, maybe a tax to inflation or something like that. So if it was like, you know, you can spend up to maybe $10,000 of your assets as an individual, standard citizen, it's not an accredited investor per year on crypto investments if you want to. But they'll set a limit of some kind and tack it to inflation. So that would make sense to me. But right now, you just can't. So if it's an ICO, which, you know, there's a lot of ton of ICOs happening. Which, by the way, there was this big explosion of ICOs last year, a huge influx of numbers of new coin offering, ICO, initial coin offering, by the way. It's the first time I'm going to say, hey, I've got tokens available, would you like to buy some? That's my initial coin offering. There was like 200 or so, I think, that sprung up last year. Half of them are already done. They have a better success rate at this point than startups, but not by much. So just because it's an ICO doesn't mean it's worth anything. And actually, most of these things are just terrible. Dogecoin, or Dogecoin, really. Dogecoin is worth, it's crazy that it's worth anything because it was created as a joke to poke fun at the people who were investing in crypto at the time. And it's been completely unmaintained for like 5 years. Nobody's done anything with that network in like 5 years. And yet, for some reason, it still has value. It's just bizarre. It's like half the population just didn't get the joke. Right? But again, it's a consensus that makes value. That's why Dogecoin has value, even though I think it's the dumbest out. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about market cap on this. Because if you talk about market cap on crypto, this is the sort of thing you kind of see sometimes. That Bitcoin is a huge chunk of the overall crypto market, right? Ethereum is a big chunk. Ripple, right? You've got that. You've got NEOs up there. They're kind of the rest of the Chinese plans and stuff. So, but every one of these little blocks is an ICO that's out there somewhere. Most of them don't amount to much. So the market cap on all of this is interesting. And I'm going to show you something a little quick. Notice here real quick, this is a visualization that we're going to go through real quick. This block represents $100 billion worth of capital. Our silver investment in the world is less than $100 billion. What was it? $17 billion. Whole world of silver, $17 billion. Cryptocurrencies right now, they're totaling those up to $100 billion for Bitcoin alone. Actually, it's about 141 as of last month. So 41% larger than that block there is what you're seeing is the current value. But let's watch this for a second. So here's your biggest companies by comparison. Apple, Microsoft, Alphabet, Facebook, Amazon. You have these richest people in the world. Bill Gates has more valuation or did up until the beginning of this year than Bitcoin. California, Fed balance sheet, our real currency, gold, here's the stock markets. Right? So if you go in here, global my supply, narrow and broad. And so I'll pick up speed here in a second because this is a case. So once we get into global debt, it starts really getting cold. Right? So $70 trillion worth of global debt was added in the last decade. China's debt is a percentage of GDP, is pretty large. Global real estate, commercial, agricultural, this is residential down here. 29, this one, 62, and $26 trillion each. And derivatives, here's where it gets crazy, and so we have to see here. There we go. And these are the derivative values. And it's just not slow. Thank you, Tula. Now that was the bottom end of the estimate. Now we're in the top end of the estimate of derivatives. And so keep going for a few seconds here. And almost there. Again, that's big. We're not talking about a lot of money here, but if you want to talk about the overall capital of the world, Bitcoin's tiny. Crypto is tiny. The entire market of crypto is just a drop in the bucket of the world's capital markets. And yet we're spending a tremendous amount of time, effort, and energy on it right now. It's actually kind of out of scale, right? If you really want to talk about a lot of capital, you should be thinking about derivatives and real estate. That's where all of the capital really is flowing. Crypto has an interesting aspect to it because I can get into it. I can't get into derivatives very easily. I can't get into global real estate very easily. I can get into crypto today. What do you think? Crypto is sort of democratic in that sense because it's not centrally controlled. It's decentralized. There is no central authority ruling over most cryptocurrencies. The ones that do, a lot of people say, well, you're not going to cryptocurrency. You're using a token system or something like that. But it's not really what we define as a cryptocurrency. So, think about the cap, and then also think about efficiency. So this has to do with how fast transactions travel. And this one, by the way, this was a promo from the group that's developing Lightning. This does not exist yet. This is theoretical capacity that has not been verified as existing. We don't know if it's really going to work yet. We'll see. But they're saying that they're going to use Lightning Network on top of Bitcoin. It's going to process something like a billion transactions a second. Are you kidding? I'm skeptical. Visa processes 24,000 transactions per second. You have Bolt 1500, PayPal 193. You get out Bitcoin 7. Okay. Bitcoin current implementation 7. Ethereum 20. So Ethereum's like more than twice as efficient as Bitcoin, but that doesn't really mean a whole lot. Not at that scale. So one of the problems that we have right now is that the amount of transactions that these networks can do are so small and so constrained that they're not very efficient in markets. So therefore, you get this kind of a problem. This is the cost per Bitcoin transaction going from December of 2016 to December of 2017. You can see it's really peaked out. $120 per transaction. You're gonna buy a bottle of water if it costs you $120 to process the transaction. Nobody's buying anything with Bitcoin that's under about $5,000, $10,000. Because that's where it actually starts gaining money over using banks to do the transaction. There's no point in using Bitcoin for a small was at a time, a friend used to tip people in Bitcoin. He'd tip people 2 to 3 Bitcoins at a time. And if they held on to them, they got some money there, right? And at the time, it was efficient enough, and the price was low enough, the transaction cost was low enough, that you could do that, and it was pretty efficient, it made sense. The problem now is that Bitcoin now uses more energy than a lot of third-tier level nations. They passed up Denmark about a month ago. Bitcoin uses more power, just Bitcoin, not the whole crypto market, just Bitcoin uses more power than Denmark right now to run. There's a lot of inefficiency there, and a lot of it comes down to Bitcoin was an alpha test implementation of the concept of blockchain. It's not a very good implementation. It's not very efficient. It's not well designed. It hit some good concepts pretty well, but it really failed at efficiency and scalability. So Bitcoin is not a long-term pony you can ride. Now, they might make a new blockchain of some type or a new type of network to process transactions and call it Bitcoin 2 or Bitcoin rebooted or whatever they're going to call it. They can apply a new name or that name to a new set of technologies. That'll make it more efficient. But you're never going to turn the existing Bitcoin blockchain into something that's efficient to use on a large scale. It just can't happen. It's non-scalable. And it's geometric. You can see this is actually a geometric growth curve, right? This is not linear growth. We can't make hardware fast enough to keep up with that growth curve. You can't. So there's no way that Bitcoin is a long-term sustainable solution, nor is any current blockchain system that exists. So think about this for a moment. Ethereum, this is Ethereum's system. Is that a currency or an asset? I'd say it's an asset because it has smart contracts that do work. Right? It's no longer just a currency. You can use it as a unit of exchange. But it does something else that money doesn't do. It does work. It's weird. But I'd start to qualify that as an asset for this point. We'll see what the IRS says. SEC, by the way, has decided because they're looking at the cryptocurrency exchanges, right? You go and you say, here's $10,000 on my bank account, I'll take one Bitcoin, thank you very much. That goes in my Bitcoin wallet. Program on my computer, but it's supposed to be my wallet. The SEC decided that they want to nail those people that are doing the exchanges. So they decided that all crypto is actually a currency. And that means that all the exchanges have to comply with money exchange rules, which are pretty significant and pretty costly to comply with. So they're in a lot of trouble in that regard, currency, the exchange story, except for one, because Goldman Sachs bought them. And the SEC said, well, since you're buying them, everything's forgiven, you ask for them. We'll not look at anything in them, right? Because we have a lot of Goldman Sachs people in the government, of course. So there's one cryptocurrency exchange. I'm trying to remember what it was. I don't know. Does anybody remember what that was? It was the one I got bought by Circle, Goldman Sachs directly. Anyway, there's one cryptocurrency exchange that won't forget. What's that?
Is that Steven Seagal one? Yeah, I thought he had one.
I'd tell me he's not in this car. All right, so, you know, the real issue that I come down to is that if you're looking at the SEC or you're looking at the IRS rules and you're wanting to know whether or not it's a currency or an asset, we're not dealing with really funny money, in my opinion. It doesn't really make much sense if the IRS and the SEC are trying to make these rules. They don't seem to have the lexicon yet. They don't seem to have the concept yet. And it starts feeling after a while, like you're in kind of the, or, you know, you're in the casino now, you're gambling. We don't really know what the outcome's going to be. It's a game of chance. Everybody's really excited. Adrenaline's high. But what the outcome is, we're not really sure. And after you start looking at these charts for a while, and you find out that, well, I'll show you later, there's actually only four major players in Bitcoin. That's it. All of us are just gnats on the windshield. There's four major players in Bitcoin that are doing the transaction already. And whenever they decide to tank the economy on Bitcoin, they just do it. They're called whales. And they call them whales because whenever they move, everything in the water around them has to move. There's no other choice, right? So when one of the whales decides to tank the economy, they can do it. Because they have enough force, enough consensus that they can carry in order to change the direction of the wind. So when you see big drops like this, you start wondering if you're really in that friendly casino we were looking at before, or if you might be maybe in this casino. This would not be a casino I want to play in if I was moving on. So, a lot of people say that this is the end of banking. I don't think so. I think banks are going to be here for a while. I do think banks are going to be smaller. I don't think banks are going to be as big as they are now. Because third-party decentralized transaction networks are going to succeed. We're going to get it right in some way. Actually have the technology now, we just haven't popularized it yet. And banks will lose a lot of volume of transactions. So the future doesn't look real bright for banks at the moment, but I don't think they're going away entirely. I think their role in the economy is going to be reduced, though. Because there's only so much that I want someone as a bank to do for me. There's only so much I want them to do. Everything else I'd really rather them not be in my way and not charge me for. So everything that I don't want them to charge me for is going to become stuff that they're not going to be able to get people to do with. Actually a lot. It's a lot of small transactions. So even if you think that this might be the end of the banking industry, I don't really think so because the other force that combats that is that people always have Luddites, right? And if you don't know about Luddites, John Ludd was supposedly this guy who led a revolt to break all of the automated looms that had just caused the layoff of so many workers in England at the time. And John Ludd and the Luddites had followed him. They would break into the factories that they were just fired from, and they would try to destroy the machines that were replacing them. This is early industrial automation, taking jobs, and people revolting against it. Sound familiar at all? Well, Luddites are still with us. And I think we'll see them, for instance, when we start automating things like truck driving. I won't doubt that the Luddites will unionize. try to get laws passed and politicians bribed and everything that they can do in order to grease enough palms to make sure that they don't lose their jobs to automation. It may not succeed. It depends actually on how much money the people with the automation systems want to pay as a competitive bribe. So if the automators outbribe the truckers, which I think they probably will, the automators are going to win, the truckers are all going to be out of business anyway. But I think the Luddites play a factor because they are a stalling tactic and they delay the deployment and adoption of the technologies. They delay the effectiveness of it over time. And not necessarily, I'm not calling out anybody who thinks that automation and getting rid of jobs is a bad thing. I don't necessarily disagree with you, but at the same time, I kind of have a sense of inevitability. That leads into another topic, which has to do with the fact that what happens when we don't really have a lot of physical work that anybody wants to pay us humans to do anymore. Because that's coming. Because pulling a crank is not going to make anybody any money. There is no job out there to pull a crank. There used to be. There used to be a lot of jobs. As a matter of fact, I used to spend a lot of money figuring out how to make you pull a crank faster, how to make you pull it at the right rate, right? There's a lot of optimization work that was done to try to get people to operate that more like a machine. Well, now we just build a machine. So, there was an interesting video, RSA, Royal Society of Arts, I think is what it's called, British group. They put out these educational videos that are really good to go on YouTube for some time. They had one that talked about value of work and what people want to earn versus what will satisfy them to work for. It's two different numbers, right? So, people want to earn a lot more than what they're willing to take to do a job. That's a normal thing. And the study that they did on it was they found that there was this, you know, traditional economist said, well, if you pay somebody more money, then they'll work harder, they'll be more productive, and they'll generate more profits, justifying their higher pay. And if there is no decision-making whatsoever involved in the job, the RSA found that is actually true. But you can't have any decision-making involved at all. If there's any form of judgment involved in that work at all, it's not just rote mechanical movement to do that job. Paying people more money does not make them more productive, or faster, or more efficient. So, the psychology that they tested was, what exactly does this mean? If we pay somebody enough money, they set up a couple of experiments, worked with a couple of different groups of people. What they found was that there's a certain amount of money that people expect to be paid for a certain job. If you agree to pay them that amount, that takes money off the table. And now, what they really want to talk about is the job, the importance of the job, what it means to them, what it means to the company, how important is this, what am I doing, what's my contribution? Okay? People get into the thing about the job at that point. If you take money off the table, it's not a concern. If you pay them more than that, it might not affect their performance at all yet, but if you keep paying them more, their performance will actually decline. So there's this weird economic effect, and most economists are like, I don't get this at all. They started doing these experiments, but it verified out across cultures, across different geographic locations, across different educational levels, genders, races, the whole nine yards. They tested for all sorts of different controls. And they found that take the money off the table, and people are interested in the meaning of the job, not the money of the job. If you keep paying them more money, they start thinking a lot harder about what it is they're doing, because now you place all sorts of importance on it by continuing to pay them more and more money. And now they second guess themselves, and now they don't perform as well. There's an interesting effect about that. And the real issue that we come to at some point is that jobs that require judgment on our part are really what we're getting paid for now. Most of these folks in the room are IT professionals, right? And the reason why you guys have not been automated yet is because you have good judgment skills. Your judgment skills help you keep your companies and your clients out of trouble. That's why they pay you. They don't pay you just because you're fast on a keyboard. That's not the point, right? Your efficiency on keyboard, your efficiency with a mouse, not really relevant. What is relevant is you make good judgments. That's why they pay. Right? So, if it's
about how quickly you make right judgments.
What's that now?
How about how quickly we make our judgment? There are two people. Both of them capable of making.
Maybe that's the
right judgment. One makes it momentarily, another one in 5 minutes.
That could be the difference between the supervisor and the junior employee, right? It could be something like it could be a differentiation in scale there, sure. But ultimately, people want to think about the importance of the job after you've met the minimum requirement for the compensation for the job. that's what the RSA found. It's really interesting, but I think what it gets down to is this. If you keep extrapolating the process of automation throughout our economy, and you keep automating more and more things, and you get into some things that do require judgment, as we're starting to, got a friend who's an intellectual property lawyer who was telling me the other day that he's just inundated with law students who want jobs. They're coming out of law school, they have tons of education debt, they desperately want a job, they want to become a junior lawyer at the firm, they want to become a researcher, I'll be your go-to, I'll go get your coffee, I'll do your research, right? They don't need them anymore. They don't have jobs for them. They got software. It's pretty new software, but it does the legal research that a team of junior lawyers used to do. Now there's a whole wave of lawyers coming out of school that don't have jobs. They got a real problem. They're really in trouble right now. So if anybody's in law school right now, think about where you're going economically. Because, you know, going and being a junior lawyer at a firm's probably not going to work out for you. Nobody wants to hire you anymore for that purpose. Because that job has been automated. And that's an intellectual job. You want to talk about judgment, right? There's a lot of judgment involved in lawyer work, right? But the junior lawyers don't actually make judgments that impact outcomes. So therefore, their judgment isn't really worth as much. So therefore, we can automate that job a lot easier. Right? But if we keep automating more and more and more of these jobs, one of the things that happens is what we're starting to call the end of scarcity. We are still living in a scarcity-driven economy. We have scarce resources. The distribution of those resources applies value to those resources in increments. And that's how we agree upon a consensus value. What a resource is worth. But there's an issue that's happening as a result of automation and increased efficiency and distribution. And that is, let's look at these graphs. 1929 to 2009, food expenditures as a share of disposable personal income has dropped from 0.47% down to 9.47%. If you look at this one, this is food, clothing, and shelter as a percent of disposable income, just to show you that even if you include your housing, it doesn't have a big impact. Right? So, it's not isolated to these things. This is corn production in tons, right? And we've lowered the cost of corn production in tons from 1975 to 2005 from $370 down to about $100 for a ton of corn. Right? This is all adjusted for inflation, of course. So these are real dollars that we're talking about. It's not funny money. Cumulative production rate of oil pumping from 2005 down to 2015 is dropping. Long-term trend of that is the same. This one up here is battery storage. So if you've got energy storage, how much does it cost you to store that energy? The price of that has dropped dramatically over time. This one, PV modules, is photovoltaic. So here's our energy sources in the future. The cost for that used to be almost $100 per kilowatt hour, per watt of production capacity. Almost $100 in 1976. Here in 2015, we're down to less than $1. So this is a logarithmic scale too. So the thing that you should come out of this with is understanding that all of the costs of production and everything that sustains us as a biological organism, our clothing, our food, construction of our housing, all of that is dropping tremendously as we automate more and more industries and as we our distribution capacity and our distribution efficiency. These lines all seem to intersect about the same time. Around 2050, they intersect at about zero. What does that mean? It'll cost almost nothing to produce all of the bare necessities that we need to survive and to distribute them effectively so that all people have access to them.
So we become a welfare state in 2050?
No.
That's the year we're almost here.
Talk about everything. Post-scarcity society is something that scares the crap out of a lot of capitalists because there's a valuation of monetary fund or of money that happens as a relation to this. It's already happening. Our money should be worth a lot more if it was growing at the same rate that it was growing in the 1800s. By now, it should be worth a lot more, but it's not because our automation is reducing the growth rate. Now, so far, it hasn't gone net negative on us, but it will. And eventually, our money will not be worth as much. But that's the thing. How much money do you need if most of your necessities are essentially free? How much money do you really need at that point? And this is what made me think about Star Trek. Because in Star Trek, they don't need money for anything. Walk up to the replicator, make their food, you know, you want a tasty treat or whatever. to synthesize it, and it costs essentially zero. Now, in their case, they've got massive energy generating capacity and the sorts of technologies we don't have yet, but we're working on it. We're getting there. Slow. We're getting there. So, 2050 looks like a big day. Somewhere around there, around 2050 looks like a big day. But because of this, crypto involves a concept of artificial scarcity. I love this. But we have to invent scarcity in crypto in order for any unit of crypto to have any perceptible value. Because if there is an infinite amount of supply of money, how much is any dollar worth? Nothing. You have to have a limited supply of it for there to be demand for it to have a consensus value above zero. So we invented artificial scarcity for crypto for this purpose. So Bitcoin only introduced so many tokens at the very beginning of its evolution. And it's programmed, by the way, the network as a whole is programmed, that when a certain market cap is reached, more of the tokens that are predetermined will be released into the pool available for use. It controls the money supply only in one direction, though. So as the market cap on Bitcoin grows, it slowly releases more tokens programmatically on the network. You know, it does it itself. Nobody had a master control board hitting the buttons to do it. It's all programmed in ahead of time. And more supply comes in order to alleviate the pressure. That's a good thing economically. The problem is they can't walk it back. You can't pull those tokens back out of the money supply if there's a tank, right? If the value of the tanks, normally you would want to pull the supply out in order to drive the value of it back up. You can't do that. So Bitcoin will succeed as long as it continues to grow. But as soon as it stops growing, it will die. It's a lot like a cancer. As a resemblance, so sort of there. But I want to talk about the replicator thing, and I bear with it for just a moment. This is just a wonderful thing. I love this. This is when the Star Trek people, for the first time, this is from Enterprise, if you recognize the series. This is when they first come across their first replicator. I just love this.
Far more advanced to water. Cold.
They have speakers. So she said water cold, right? That's water. Uh-oh. Just happened. I just lost my connection.
So did I think I had an engineer?
Oh, we could be turned off here, but I don't know. Sorry, it idled out. Hang on a second.
That happens, the things automatically start to turn off.
This is why we have value.
I gotta hit the button and turn it back on. Yeah.
Automatic pause in your presentation.
Take a minute for that.
We're
back up.
This is sorry.
Yeah.
I'll summarize because I'm not going to make a slip here. Okay, but basically, you know, she says glass water cold makes glass water. She says, okay, fine, it's good water. Okay. This is supposed to be an alien device that's from them. They don't know where it came from. That's the history about this piece of the story. Then the other guy, I can't remember his name, he says, like a pan-fried bass, right? Or pan-fried catfish. There's a plate, a fork, pan-fried catfish on it. Looks good, picks it up, smells it. It's a real thing. Uses the fork, takes a bite. Pretty good. Not bad, right? The simulation of the real thing was detailed enough that it passed the sniff test and it passed the taste test too. Right. Replicators are a real thing. We're going to work toward them. As soon as I can get a computer.
How did the first replicator know what a bass was?
Know what a bass was?
Know what a pan-fried bass is if it was boring.
So apparently it had to invade your computer systems to get the information out about it. What a catfish was. How to make a pan-fried catfish as a recipe. And then it synthesized it out. That's what they said.
Trying here.
There it goes. Ah, okay, here we go.
They send a power up command all over every night.
There we go.
Okay. So this is the replicator today. Right? This is the VaporBot replicator too. It's a pretty new model. This shape is inside of it. It's made right here. That's been great. This is very difficult to do right now. This is one of the features of the new VaporBot replicator too. It's going to do these incredibly complicated nested geodesic shapes. We're dealing still with plastics. We've got 3D printers that have 3D metal. We've got stuff that can do food printing. Right? They actually do printable frosting now for cakes. So our capability to replicate objects is increasing, but we lack things that Star Trek had in terms of massive amounts of power generation and to be able to just create matter out of thin air using energy alone. So we don't have those technologies yet. The power generation capacity is actually one of the big ones that we're way behind on that. But you can see that the cost of making a prototype now has dropped dramatically for anybody that's building it. So electronics devices, any kind of if you're building dog tags or dog collars or something, you can prototype those things so cheaply now compared to what it cost just 10 years ago to prototype those inventions. So it's greasing the wheels of innovation now. And that's one of the things that we see with replication, or 3D printers, whatever you want to call them. Replicators are speeding along innovation because they're lowering the cost of prototyping new inventions. So we're rapidly moving in that direction. And every time we have a new innovation in replication technology, it drastically accelerates its demand. This is a compounding acceleration that's just getting more and more intense as time goes on. I have no doubt that we will reach the point where we will materialize a pan-fried a catfish on plate someday. Might not be in my lifetime, but maybe my grandma. I remember one time my great grandmother asked her. She was born long enough ago that she remembers the first automobile that was brought into the state of Kentucky to the state fair, and she got to see the moonlight in her lifetime. And I asked her about that because I was very curious about it. Shortly before she passed away, I said, "Man, that's just such a crazy thing to see from the time you were a small child." Because she told me one of the first things I remember seeing this technology was this crazy automobile. Brought it to the state fair when I was about 7. It's insane. It was the first automobile brought into the state of Kentucky, for God's sakes, right? And she saw the moon landing 70 years later. It's incredible, right? I don't have any idea what I can expect to see in my lifetime at this point because of what she saw. And we're moving much faster now. So I don't know, bets are off. I'm not going to try to do the crystal ball. The production curves. And the one thing that's kind of missing from those production curves is distribution costs have not declined as fast as anything else. This is why, right now, we can produce enough food to feed everybody in the world, no problem. We already can do that. We're doing it now. But we can't get it to the people that want it effectively enough, efficiently enough, that we're all okay with doing it. So it's not the production capacity that's lacking, it's the distribution efficiency. Right? As distribution efficiency declines, and we're all watching Amazon right now, figuring out how they're doing it and what they're doing. But replicators are like the infinite reduction of complexity of distribution because it's all mass produced on site when you need one off, right? That is the end of distribution technology, is the replicator. We're moving in that direction quickly. But if you're skeptical, there is one thing that still keeps declining in value over time. That's like the one real fixed quantity thing that we have in the world. We can divide it up as much as we want into smaller and smaller parcels, but we can't ignore the very soon. Knows maybe we might have established colonies on Mars or Venus at some point and we'll get more land. There was a crazy thing in one of the Star Trek episodes where Jean-Luc Picard was tempted to leave the Enterprise and join a project called the Atlantis Project, where they were going to take an entire tectonic plate, and lift it out of the ocean through geoengineering and create a whole new continent upon which they could then build new structures and have more land, right, on Earth. And that was one of the things that came up in Star Trek as well. Maybe, I don't know. It's a little bit beyond me, it's out of my pay grade. But I could see that eventually we could wind up generating more land somehow. I've also heard of the idea of a geostationary orbital ring, 22,300 miles straight up from us, all the way around the Earth, wrapped around. If you made it just 1 mile wide, it does something like 8 times the surface area of the planet Earth. space elevator. Space elevator will get you there.
Yeah.
The ring is what we build once we have the elevator.
It's right. Called Ring World.
Yeah. Hmm. Pretty much.
It's a series of mountains.
Yeah. And we get a tremendous amount of increase in arable mountain space. So there are ways that we might be able to change even this problem too in the future. This housing cost is really kind of deceptive because it's not the house that costs the money. The house actually costs less now in adjusted real dollars. It's the land. It's the land that costs the money. The land is what's going on, not the house. So a lot of crypto comes down to organizational structure. And these are classical organizational structure graphs. You guys have probably seen these from college or whatever. You got centralized structures where you've got stations, backed by links to a hub, right? Everything has to go to the hub. The hub is the controller. The hub makes the decisions. The hub determines reality, right? We have processes that we're working on this already. And then you've got decentralized networks. And in this case, you've got kind of sub-hubs. None of them are really dominant necessarily. One of them might have more important role than another. But nodes form off of hubs, and the hubs can connect to each other. The messages can be passed between hubs to different nodes. Right? It's a bit more efficient than this, because everything has to pass through a single hub. So all communication and all transactions are limited by the processing capability of the hub. In this case, you can divide up that power amongst many nodes. Right? Then there's distributed network. The distributed network is the most efficient network because it distributes capacity across all nodes in the network. And all of the nodes essentially have kind of the same jobs, kind of the same capabilities to pass messages along, and usually about the same kind of processing power ultimately. So a network of distributed nodes is actually a lot more efficient in doing work than any of the other two. Now there's an easy comparison we can make here to our current economic systems. This is banking. We have a central bank. Everything goes to the central bank. This is blockchain, because everything goes through pools. The pools are where the controllers of how things work. And I haven't really brought up the topic of Tangle yet. Tangle's new, a couple years old. Tangle's a new technology that really is distributed network, not a decentralized network. And one of the things that's really interesting about Tangle, there's a company called IOTA, or a group called IOTA. But they're driving the effort behind Tangle. It's a different kind of mathematics than blockchain. It's not a blockchain, it's a Tangle. It's a different thing. One thing that's really interesting about Tangle is that Tangle actually gets more efficient the larger it gets. The more transaction volume, the more nodes on the network, it actually gets more efficient over time. That's one of the benefits of a truly distributed network. The mathematics of it seems to work out. I haven't seen it demonstrated in real time to tell you whether or not it really is true, because they may not do the right implementation of this concept. They might screw it up. It's possible. But this is going to win. When we're talking about large transaction processing networks, Tangle or something like it is going to be what we're going to use in the future, not blockchain. Blockchain has really good uses, though, in some cases. But you can't have a lot of transaction volume, or otherwise you get a geometric growth problem. Complexity goes up, becomes difficult to mine, becomes difficult to add more blocks in, and it just creeps to a halt, becomes more expensive to operate over time and geometrically. So, Tangle doesn't. So, if you want to do electronic medical records, blockchain might be good, actually. That could be a good way to store electronic medical records. You want to do title transfer records, like what your state auditor or your county auditor normally keeps track of. Blockchain can be really good for that. Not a high transaction volume. It takes a long time to build up a new blockchain when you're talking about title transfers, right? Even auto title transfers, I think you can even do blockchain for that, even with the increased transaction level. I think it would still work. And I think one of my biggest interests in what I think blockchain should really be used for is for voting. When we do elections, there should be a blockchain that our votes go into, because everything can be cross-checked. Nobody can get in there and jam. It's an amazing concept, right? Great. To extend that one more thing, I'll throw this out, and I'm never going to try to actually do this myself because I want to get a shot. If somebody out there is bold enough and thinks they got the willpower and the capability to survive the process, I would love to see some type of way to force Congress, or at least national level politicians, to use a blockchain for all of their election spending. So any donations to their election goes into the blockchain. Any spending on the election comes out of the blockchain. No anonymity, right? We're not going to make it an anonymous network at that point. Everybody has a federal ID. Dark money goes away. And if you get caught doing something outside the blockchain, heavy penalties, right? Like ejected from office, never able to run again, spend some time in jail.
There's one flaw in that thing.
Budget. Congress will never pass it.
Why that doesn't pass it because everyone's making the rules.
Guess how you can do it, though? We can do exactly what the students down in Florida are doing to their legislators. We can put pressure on the state legislators to force them to do it with the threat of kicking them all out of Congress if they don't regardless of how the state passes it. They don't do it again, they'll do it. If they believe the threat, just like they did in Florida, all of those people were on the NRA payroll. None of them wanted to vote for that. They knew they would lose their jobs. We put our politicians in the same position at the state level, we can create a constitutional convention and we can't get it passed. And it doesn't matter what Congress sends out, it doesn't matter. Congress can't do anything.
The state is getting closer to being reality.
I think so too. So, like I said, I'm not running that effort. I'm
trying to disappear though.
But I think that's where blockchain can be really, really valuable and really helpful to us. So blockchain as a technology, I don't want to get caught up in tearing down blockchain so much, because it's not really that the technology is bad, it's just that we applied it to the wrong thing. We came up with a good idea that a low volume transaction scale, it worked. But now that we're putting more and more transaction volume into it, it doesn't work anymore, it doesn't scale. Right? So I think ultimately, did you have a question?
No, I didn't.
But I think ultimately we're gonna wind up using blockchain for situations where we have low volume transaction systems, where we want indelible records that are difficult to forge, like elections. Health records, right? Like maybe it's we can see eventually our laws and blockchains. That'd be kind of cool. That would prevent. There was a problem about a decade and a half or so where a copyist who worked for Congress changed the law when he copied it into the official record. That's the law of the land, not what Congress voted for. And Congress can't stop them from doing it either. That became the model land just because a copyist changed the law when they were writing it into the official record. One person changed a nationally passed piece of legislation by our entire Congress, all of our elected representatives, thwarted by one person with a typewriter. Right? It's crazy. You couldn't do that if our laws were encoded in a blockchain. It wouldn't be possible. So structure really is important, and it's really important when we start thinking about this. This is a visualization of all of the transactions that happened on the Bitcoin blockchain ever since the day it started. And I think it stops in 2017 supply. But this is, up until fairly recently, this is the whole transaction right in blockchain, visualized in such a way that the heuristics on all of the transactions to figure out who are the true parties behind all these transactions. Because we can look at the timing of them, we can look at the amounts, we can look at the destination addresses and the source heuristic models on it, and we can identify who did it. There are four major actors in Bitcoin. They make up over 97% of the transactions on Bitcoin. Four entities. That's it. I think this one right here might be Satoshi. They started the network, they got these long chains that lead into the rest of the network. If I had to make a bet, I'd say that's Satoshi Nakamoto right there, whoever that is, or whatever group of people that is. And they're still active and still trading. They may have released the software and disappeared from public sight, but they're still using it. These other three entities, not really entirely certain. I'm kind of guessing that one of them might actually be a sizable national government of some kind, fill in the blank there. One of them might be another sizable national government, fill in another blank there. And I think the third one's probably a cabal of investors. I mean, we're talking about some sense. It's almost certainly one of these as well. Right? So, four actors controlling 97% of the transaction volume, and this is supposed to be decentralized. Is that decentralized? I don't think it is at all. Just one of them decides to put their hand on the scale and it screws us all. Right? And they can do it. They've done it. Goldman did it just this past year. They put out all sorts of FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt, about crypto and said, you guys gotta get out of crypto. You gotta dump all your crypto, sell it, just get out of it. It's terrible, it's dangerous, you're gonna lose all your money. Right? All of their people started dumping crypto, however much they had, right? Because your financial advisor is telling you, get out now, right? So they started dumping their crypto. They created a kind of a run, and all of a sudden, everybody's trying to dump their crypto. And the whole crypto market tanked horribly, right? Valuation went down incredibly. And then, as soon as it hit a certain peak at the bottom, or a certain trough at the bottom, Goldman swamped up a whole bunch of it, man. Bought it all, discount prices, fire sale. Bought it all. And then, within a day, produced a book, The Crypto Bible. Here's what you need to know about crypto investing. that we just told you to get out of a month ago. They totally manipulated that market. If it was a regulated market, there'd be Goldman Sachs executives right now on trial that are looking at jail time. But, you know, if we don't have regulated markets, I'm of the opinion that a good economic market is a well-regulated market. That doesn't mean over-regulated, it's well-regulated. That's the difference. Everybody, there's a certain thing in some sectors of capitalism that says any regulation is bad. I don't deal in drugs or slaves or prostitution rates. So I think regulation is a good thing generally as long as it's applied in an intelligent fashion. And it's used to enforce the purposes that we want to use this thing for rather than somebody else's personal interest. So good regulation would be good, because if we don't have good regulation, we're going to wind up with this. That'll happen if we don't regulate.
So what's wrong with this?
Well, so here's the thing. If we go down here, you know what comes right after this? It's going to be this. We're going to dumbass money after that. It's idiocracy. I love that film. This is $10 million. What Paul and Asky have paid something. $10 million. And what they bought with that was a big ass box of fries. We're talking about deflation. So I really think that IOTA is really venturing into the area where it could really be a currency. A true currency with high volume transaction capabilities. Decentralized in such a way that we actually have a way to get into it, even if it's on a small scale. We can benefit and own a portion of this, and it'll extend and scale well. This, I think, is a healthy market to get into, and it might actually be something that someday, hopefully, we'll dig up whatever is the remnants of our computers and look at it and say, oh my god, I found the first IOTA token ever discovered in history, right? This is a big archaeological find. There'll be something like this little point over here, maybe.
You're providing computers still run out of electricity, man.
Yeah, don't store your first IOTA coin on a flash drive.
USB flash drive?
Yeah. Burn it into, what was that? They burn it into gold disks, as gold CDs, basically, layered in some kind of high test plastic or something. That's supposed to be the best we've got.
That's gold press back.
Yeah, so because of the scalability and usability increases over time, I love IOTA. I think Tangle is fantastic. Not really a big currency out there you can buy on it yet. But if I was going to invest in cryptocurrency today, a significant amount, to put money and hold tokens for any reason, it would be this stuff. It would have to be. Let's get back real quick to the difference between proof of work and what's now been suggested as an alternative. It's called proof of stake. I'm kind of a fan of proof of work because it's something we're familiar with. If you do work, actually my computer does work. I bought a computer to make it do my work. It's my slave, but it's a machine out here. So I bought a computer to make it do my work. It doesn't work, I get money. I get that. That makes sense to me. There's work involved, energy is expended, some kind of exchange happens, and out of that income, the net out of that is that I make money. That makes a lot of sense. Proof of stake is a backup plan for bad blockchain design. What they're saying is, let's get rid of all of the computation things and all of the mining and all of that. Let's just make it so that if you have more stake in Bitcoin, then your decision actually becomes consensus reality instead of the mass. So in other words, now we're going to let the biggest whales control consensus reality exclusively to the detriment of everybody else in the network. That's what proof of stake represents. It solves the mathematical problem of Bitcoin's geometric increase in complexity because it gets rid of that. Because now you don't need to have miners, you don't need to have transaction validation because you've basically created a new centralized bank. The central bank is now whoever has the most money. That's the central bank. And they make all the decisions. Who's comfortable with that? Anybody? I'm not a big fan of proof of stake. I think it's a terrible idea. I think it's a bad solution to a bad problem, right? Well, bad solution to an interesting problem. I think there's good solutions to that interesting problem, but they don't involve switching over to a point where the biggest whale has the decision on everything. That's not a bad idea. It's really personal interest issues for everybody. So, I'm a big fan of mining. Actually, I have it in my blood. I have relatives that came from Kentucky, Tennessee border. They mined bituminous coal out of the earth down there, spent generations doing it. My family wound up getting out of it, but black money became a reality, and we moved up here since then, and I've been here ever since. But I gotta tell you, I feel something in common with these folks, because I work too.
Well, you know, one of the things, was in one of the heavy metal magazines that I read, everything follows the basic laws of conservation of energy and matter, okay? And you never can get more out of the system than you put into it. But the people who are, and like you said, the centralized, well, what they've done is they convinced other people to get less out of the system than they put into it, and then they take out.
Which we call a?
Yeah.
Ponzi scheme.
Right. But
that's what that is.
But that's basically, you know, what you're talking about, you know, centralized wealth making the decisions. And then, you know, in that case, somebody who had the wealth leveraged that to get other people to give him more money without giving them anything in return. And that generally is what's happened in many societies. And that's also why they were pulling people out of their homes in France, chopping their heads off during the French Revolution.
Oh,
yeah.
Well, it's not just politics, it's actually social struggle.
Yeah. The only equalizing force that we have is the middle class. If you deteriorate the middle class, you have nothing to keep these people. You know,
I totally agree. Totally agree. So I find that
the miners are
valued in what the miners do, because they do hard work that has value that we appreciate, that we place value in. And by doing crypto mining, we are doing something for the network that has value to the network that other people would pay us to do. That's a good thing. Personal opinion, right? There's a problem, of course, with real miners. That is this dilemma of coal miners that have been employed in the market at the time. Let's go back to 1950. You think whatever Trump's going to do is going to really impact this seriously?
No.
You can't. Automation has killed that market. There is no market for being a coal miner anymore. We're not going back to the days of hard hats and lanterns and donkeys and canaries and kids. We're not going back. It's just not going to happen. The automation is too good. It's too cheap. Our coal production has not dropped off. Our coal production has continued to go up, and yet our employees are dropping off because automation is taking their place. So there's really no sense in trying to preserve jobs that are going away to automation, in my personal opinion. So I have a little bit of a suggestion. One of the other things I did want to talk about, everybody hates the term income inequality, but this is a graphic representation of what everything means. As automation has increased and as profits gained from automation have increased, only 1% of the population is reaping the rewards of most of that increased efficiency, even though all of their employees are paying the price of that new technology being adopted. That's a problem. I see this problem, right? Now, I don't like the idea of wealth relocation, wealth redistribution. I'm not a big fan of that. But this does not look good. This is not healthy. This kind of a pattern leads to people in the streets with pitchforks and torches going after people that do have money. I'd like to be one of those people with money. I don't like pitchforks, I don't like torches, right? I'd like to resolve this before it becomes a major problem. And you know, the more we look at it, we go from lots of people building things, machines building things. Lots of people doing things, machines doing things. Making bread, machines making bread. It's hitting every sector of the economy. People running on an oil rig, the oil rig running itself. Not a lot of jobs to get in for this. The time's going to come, all of the trucks are driverless. When all of the cars are driverless. What happens to all those people that are driving right now for work? We already have taxi cab drivers committing suicide in New York City right now because of Uber. And Uber's not even automated yet. You know, they had that accident that killed a pedestrian recently, right? How long do you think that's going to keep them from continuing to experiment with self-driving cars?
That's just going to go somewhere else.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they're just going to move to some other place and continue the testing until they work it out, right? And how many tens of thousands of lives, on the other side of this issue, how many tens of thousands of lives would be saved by automated self-driving cars every year? Something like 30,000 people a year die in the United States from car wrecks.
That's just in the U.S.
That's just in the U.S. How many lives would we save by having those automated cars? But how many jobs are we going to lose? You want to talk about a tough decision here, right?
How many jobless are going to be able to afford to buy the cars?
Well, that depends, doesn't it? Because that depends on how good our replicators are.
Great, then they can't afford
to. Because if the replicators bring down the production cost, then I don't need as much money to buy a car. Right? And actually, to be honest with you, the cars that I was looking at recently, my car is like 20 years old, it's about to give up the goods. I'm going to drive the wheels right off of it if I can. But, because I'm that kind of guy. But looking at a new car, the value of that car is way higher than what they want to charge me for it economically. It's way higher. Compared to the car about 20 years ago, this thing is like, it's got to be at least 5 times the financial value of the car about 20 years ago in terms of features and capabilities and efficiency and fuel economy and all of this. It's amazing. And it's only like $5,000 more than what I paid 20 years ago for a car that's way inferior because our automation is getting awesome. And it's lowering, even though the cost of cars isn't necessarily going down, the cost of iPhones, but their capabilities keep increasing. It's that Moore's Law factor, right? We keep increasing the capabilities just to stabilize the prices. And that's where we're fighting right now. Boy, we better get more functionality out of this for the next gen, or we can't keep the price the same. Because the natural tendency is to drive the price down. Because the automation and the miniaturization and the efficiencies are increasing so quickly, and they're stacking on top of each other. Anybody recognize this?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Love this. Union Terminal has these beautiful frescoes, and I love this one. But I had a realization, I saw it the other night. I think these two guys are the only ones left standing right now. Metal workers. And they're not long for this world either. All of these professions are gone now. All of these roles in society are gone. We don't have those roles anymore. We've invented new roles to take over those places and fill those voids. Those roles are gone. These guys have been gone soon too.
Right. I hate to cut this short, but we need to wrap up.
Okay. Let me get to the summary of this then. I want to put forward one idea that I think is actually really, maybe it's a good idea, maybe it's not. You guys tell me. There was this concept called the Lex Agraria, Tiberius Gracchus, Roman Empire, Western Roman Empire, about 128 BC, somewhere around there. 120 BC, sorry. Introduced the idea that Rome had captured all this land, and we had generational deprivation of the masses by the senatorial class. They basically continually bought their land up, turned it into profitable real estate and farming land, and hired them back as slaves on it, right? And so the mass of the population was not enslaved, economically or otherwise. So this doesn't build a good economy. Just like the Confederate South didn't have a good economy, same thing with Rome. Right? They needed to do something about it. Tiberius Gracchus and his brother, Gaius Gracchus, came up with the idea of the Lex Agraria. The idea was, Rome seized all this land from other people. Let's be honest, they gave a lot of people to get it, right? But now we have all this land that's state-owned. And we've let people squat on it and use it for different purposes and things that they don't legally own it for. But let's take the land that's not claimed yet, divide it up, take all these people that are serfs, give them a land, let them own a share of the productivity of the empire. So they gave them something that didn't break the law. It didn't take away property from anybody. But it gave a whole bunch of people a share of the economy that they were sweating and laboring for without any benefit. And Gaius and Tiberius both wound up being dragged to their deaths by the Senate anyway. But the law went through. And Sulla, who was really not interested in this kind of idea of distributing wealth to the plebs, he let it go because he was too freaking popular to play with. Not mess with it. So it stayed in the wall. And those people got the land. And it probably rejuvenated the empire for another 400 years or so. So they reignited their economy and they went with a much bigger economy with more people participating, more people generating wealth, more people innovating, more people creating things for their own self-benefit, but ultimately sharing it eventually with others. And it spread. I think we might need something akin to the Lex Agraria. Again, it's going to revolve around some of the concepts we talked about, ASIC mining, GPU mining, crypto mining. But we're really talking about automation redistribution, not wealth redistribution. This is what comes. I'll call it the Lex Technologica for any better term available yet. Workers earn shares of their company as a severance when their jobs are automated. Not that they get all of it. Share. This is not wealth redistribution. This is gained efficiency profit sharing. I'm going to cooperate with my boss in my job being automated. As a reward for being cooperative, I'm going to get a share of the efficiency gains that are going to be gained by the company over the life of the time that replacement of my labor is an automated system. Right? As long as I cooperate, you can make it smooth. That both parties benefit from this exchange, right? Workers gain passive income, plus they can pursue other worker interests, they can go get another job. You could have people that go through 5 different careers and wind up with shares of 5 different companies. That's their retirement, right? And lastly, I'm sorry, this isn't lastly, but you need major career retraining to make this possible, obviously. It's something our government has not been very good about. Maybe this isn't AmeriCorps thing. Maybe this is a volunteer effort we should do. Maybe it's not best done by the perhaps. But it needs to happen. The training has to be there to make this work. But lastly, the owner is still getting productivity and the resulting profits from the efficiency gains that they wanted in the first place when they wanted to set up the automation. What they didn't have to do is they didn't have to fight a union, they didn't have to fight the suing employees, and they didn't have to deal with lower productivity on the way out. All the employees are trying to drag the system down and prevent it from being in. So the efficiency gains up. So they ought to make more money long term just because they didn't have to fight it all the way. When Norwood, had GM plant, when it shut down, they were sued for decades. How much did they actually gain from shutting down that plant? They were trying to cut costs. They were trying to save money. You think they really saved any money? I don't know. That sounds tough. If they did save any money, it was delayed by decades because all that money went to lawyers to fight them in court. Get out of that system. Stop paying lawyers to fight against automation. They're not the ones. So that's my principal concept. I'll leave you with one more concept here. Thank you very much for your time.